Hello, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Luke Spiller, and you are listening to Super Unknown with Dana Distortion.
Everybody, and welcome to my show, Super Unknown, with me, Dana Distortion. I cannot be more excited for my guest on the show today. He's stylish, he's glamorous, he wears his hair better than me, he wears his eyeliner better than me, he's the superstar frontman of the band The Struts, and he's stuck at home just like everybody else. Welcome to the show, Mr. Luke Spiller.
Hello, hello, hello.
How are you today?
I'm doing great, man. I am loving quarantine life. I'm making the most of writing, spending some time with my exceptionally beautiful girlfriend and her two lovely cats, and speaking with beautiful people like yourself.
Ah, thanks so much. I'm so excited to have you on the show today. So what does a day in your life look like these days?
Well, I've already had very physical, eventful morning, as you can imagine. And I also run like it's kind of like a live stream / home radio broadcast system where I sort of play music and I interview people. So today I interviewed Mick Rock, the legendary rock and roll photographer, which was extremely fun.
So the show is called Quarantine Radio?
Yeah, it's called Quarantine Radio, and it goes on like about four times a week. So yeah, it's a lot of fun. And honestly, it's been a great way to stay in touch with a lot of the fans from all over the world, which I think at this moment in time is really, really important, considering the fact that by the looks of it, I'm not quite sure whether we're going to be doing a lot of shows in 2020.
So what does the future hold? What's going to happen now?
Okay, so my showbiz answer, I'll give you my showbiz answer. My showbiz answer is I'm heartbroken and there's nothing more that I want to do than get out and tour and just slog it out and get back on the stage. My personal answer is probably a little bit more selfish. The fact that myself and the band have really been non-stop on the road for just over like 5 years. So despite everything that's happening, good and bad, most of it obviously bad, the silver lining out of this whole situation is for the first time in years, I've been able to exist in one place. I recently moved to LA, so it's been lovely to kind of get to know where I am, and I've got a new motorbike and I've been sort of getting out on that. And lastly as well, I've been working on a lot of new material in the comfort of sort of like my own place and being able to concentrate on that and not have like this cloud of pressure that...
Yeah, you guys have been touring for like three years straight, I think, before this,
right? It's probably
been
closer to like five. So it's you know, it's actually really kind of selfishly refreshing in a way. I can't remember the last time I had 2 months off ever.
I think it's really great that you find like positivity in this and like keep in touch with your fans. I saw on Instagram like you're doing stuff, something called Dancing with Myself. What is that?
So basically, you know, I was just thinking of things that and ways of fans to kind of stay interactive with myself. And I just thought, look, there was at that moment in time when I suggested it, I would look through my Instagram feed and of course like going through the web and the news and everything that was going on, and you know, and it was all very mundane, you know, and for good reason. But I thought, you know, I told everyone to be like, look, film yourselves like dancing to your favorite music. It could be the Struts, it could be anything, and just send it to me because it makes me happy as well. And then when I posted it, obviously it brings sort of like a little bit of joy to everyone else as well. So it started like that, basically.
That's such a great idea. I mean, it's great that you're thinking of your fans at this hard time and trying to make them happy.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm full of great ideas.
Also, recently you posted a cover of yourself and the band doing a Spice Girl song.
That is true.
Tell me about this.
Well, the song choice was something that I've been joking around with for many years. You know, I recently put out like a press statement on sort of like why we did it. And, you know, just for the simple reason of like, one, it's a fantastic song.
It really is.
Despite who performed it, you know, it really is.
I think your version is way better than the Spice Girls.
I would heavily disagree.
Hey, I'm sorry, but you don't get to decide.
Okay, I'm not deciding then. But yeah, you know, it was just like, we're doing this thing on our Struts Instagram, which is called Sunday Service. So we broadcast via Instagram TV a sort of like 10 to 15 minute episode, which features like skits that we record within quarantine, individually as band members. And then we're going to be doing a cover every week. And then on top of that, I wasn't aware of this, but last year we did a fantastic show in LA at the Wiltern, which was sold out. It was a fantastic night. The band was on fire. And we got it recorded with about four or five different cameras. So we had this idea of like, well, if we're doing this Sunday service, wouldn't it be great to start uploading like a song every week from the set in order in which it was played in the concert? So this Sunday coming, we're going to be releasing like the second song in the set at the very end of the episode.
What a great idea.
Again, I'm full
You're
of
full
them.
Of
I'm
brilliant ideas.
I'm just dropping pearls left, right and center.
See, all we need is to lock you at home so you can like come up with all these great ideas. So guys, let's watch the Struts performing Stop. It's a cover for the Spice Girls and yeah, performed by the Struts.
Live from the living room.
Welcome back to Super Unknown with our special guest, Luke Spieler. Hi again, Luke. So now we're going to play a little game I like to call the British Invasion. Are you ready?
Okay.
All right, Luke, you have 3 seconds to translate the British word I'm going to give you to American English.
Okay.
All right, ready?
Go.
3 seconds.
Holiday.
Holiday is, I guess, a vacation, what you Americans call it.
Bin.
Is the trash can.
Trainers.
Sneakers.
Crisps.
Chips.
Candy floss.
Cotton candy.
Footway.
I have no fucking idea what that is.
Sidewalk.
Pavement. Pavement's a sidewalk.
Okay, one bad point for me. The next word is chemist.
Pharmacy.
Underground.
Tube.
Ice lolly. Wait, maybe I need to do it in a British accent. Ice lolly.
Yeah, an ice lolly, I guess you would call... Fuck knows. I mean, like, I would still go up to an ice cream van and say, can I have that lolly, please?
Oh, it's a popsicle.
A popsicle? All right.
All right, stag night.
No fucking idea.
Bachelor party.
Stag do.
Jumper.
A sweater.
Nappy.
A nappy is what Americans call diapers.
Good job. You're officially an American.
There we go. Thank you very much. I'll be waiting for my green card.
So, you know, Superunknown is all about discovering new artists and supporting fresh new bands. So how about you present the next song we're going to hear?
Okay, the next song is by a band called Tool Days, and the track is called Hey There Man.
Is 21st century dandy, but I read some places that your first alter ego was actually Ace Phoenix.
So I've actually, yeah, so when I was a kid, it was Ace Phoenix. Then that turned into Sir Rock and Roll, which was my first tattoo.
Oh, yeah.
And then that was when we came to the States. And then for the Young and Dangerous album, it was the 21st century dandy, and he was a very naughty man. And then now for the next cycle, I'm going to be called Daddy Cat.
Mm. Who comes up with all these names? You?
Yeah, of course I come up with the names.
You give yourself your alter ego names. That's fantastic.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's like sometimes I hear something gets said, or, you know, like a song title comes, like, in fact, 21st Century Dandy was a song, and it was written as part two of the story of the character, which is in a song called Roll Up, which is on our first album. And I wanted 21st Century Dandy to open up the second album. So to say, like, hey, here's a continuation. But everyone went fucking mental and said I couldn't put it on there and it was too similar to Roll Up. I don't think anyone really kind of understood the concept. Anyway, so I thought, well, it's still a great title. I love it. It's kind of like an exaggerated version of myself anyway. So 21st Century Dandy came from that.
There's an even more exaggerated version of yourself?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like me. This is me being completely normal.
In just a few words, how would you describe yourself?
I'd say I'm... Fuck. I mean, I definitely would say I'm very... I get fixated. Not with every aspect of my life. But when it comes to the music, when it comes to the live show... You know, I definitely put in probably a lot more work than I have to, because I feel that if I don't do that, I'm cheating the audience from the experience that they have taken their time out and paid good money for. So I'd say, like, I'd describe myself as a dedicated performer. I'm definitely, I can be quite mischievous. But I'd like to think I'm also extremely loving as well at the same time.
Are you a spiritual person at all?
Well, I mean, I find it hard not to, because I was brought up in a Christian household in a Pentecostal church, and when I was growing up, I was taken to a lot of camps and sermons, and my dad's also a gospel singer as well, right? So, like, I saw a lot of very strange things growing up, like people jumping out of wheelchairs. Wow. And like just like people like shaking on the floor with like the Holy Spirit like going through them, and my dad like touching people on the forehead and then just
wow.
And you know what, I think I'm smart enough to know that I don't know anything. I think the only thing that we can be sure about this reality is that no one absolutely knows anything about what happens when you die.
What about astrology? Do you believe in that?
I mean...
Let me read to you what they say about Libra. I think you're Libra, right?
That's correct.
All right. So being a Libra, you're as diplomatic as you are imaginative. You love to be social and most comfortable in a group setting. You dislike arguments, which explains why you'll do anything to maintain harmony. Sounds like you, is that correct?
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right.
But yeah, it's quite funny, like my girlfriend will constantly, I'll try and just be nice and cute. You know, for instance, like, you know, I woke her up and I'd brought her like this beautiful bunch of flowers. And
how romantic.
Yeah, I mean, again, apparently Libras are extremely romantic, and you know, her response was like, it was a lovely response, but it was like, oh, Libra, thank you so much, Libra. You know, like, so I get that there is like definitely things within the universe that could give people like certain personality traits given the time and place in which they were born. But I'm more than just a star sign. I'm a star.
A star you are. So I see you keep giving your girlfriend some like naughty looks over there. Maybe she would like to come in the show and say hi to us.
She's definitely not coming.
I mean, she's hosting. She's hosting us at her house. Come on.
She literally just woke up. You know, we were drinking heavily.
I told you, I'm not wearing pants right now. More than that.
Nor is she. She's butt naked. That's why I'm not quite sure whether it would be appropriate.
That will really bring up the rating for the show. Come on.
It would. I could just show you my ass.
Okay, that will do. Thanks. Yeah. All right. Wow, that was amazing.
There we go. There's some ratings for you.
Thanks, Luke. That was appetizing. All right. So,
appetizing. So, wait till you get the main course.
How about we leave everything and just play strip poker?
Ooh la la. This is not what I signed up for.
Oh, yes, it is. Yes, it is. This is Super Unknown with Dana Distortion. We bring it all on the table.
It's true.
All right. Let's put all jokes aside. What do you miss most like in the world out there these days?
You know what? I miss I miss going and drinking at the Rainbow.
Aw, that's so romantic.
But the reason being is, one, they have like a jukebox and this area, they have a bar outside. So I
can... Oh, you're talking about the bar Rainbow.
Yeah, man. Like, what do you think I was talking about?
I thought you were like, I miss looking at the Rainbow. I thought you were talking about...
No, I couldn't give a shit about the Rainbow unless the Rainbow in the sky is selling me double tequila soda for like $8.99, you know. Then I'm
like,
not
you're
interested.
Taking that romantic shit like way too seriously. Okay, we're talking about the bar, the Rainbow, you know, where Lemmy is to go, right?
Yeah.
Lemmy is to sit there.
I'm determined to plonk my ass on one of them stools long enough where, you know, I get a fucking, at least I get a picture in that place, you know? Every time I'm going there, I'm like, where's my photo? I'm just going to take my own fucking hammer and picture and just do it myself. I'm just going to like... I'll just like, you know, set off the fire alarm and then dung, 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 and put it over someone like David Lee Roth or some shit.
I personally think you deserve it. Seriously, I've been a big fan of the Struts for like a really long time. And I saw you guys like when you just started out and you played such small rooms and you became huge and such a sensation.
Let's go with house lights. Well, you know what? It's like anything. I think it was destiny. Like the pure simple fact is this, right? I had my first record deal when I was 20 years old or 21. And I think it was just the universe just telling me that I wasn't ready for what I am now. And I genuinely believe that. Like, I think I had been playing shows in pubs from the age of 15 and 16, but my personal life and the way I viewed being a professional wasn't very professional at all. And, you know, there were a lot of hiccups. It was like within those first 3 years, apart from a band member dying, we had literally been through like every stereotypical thing that a band could go through in terms of like a stumbling block, whether that was like, you know, our label going out of business, my drummer fucking my girlfriend, or like, you know, going through years and years playing in vans, showing up with one person watching us like 300 miles away from where we were living, and an awful lot of partying as well. And like, to be honest, I didn't start to take what I do seriously in terms of live performing probably only like 2 years ago. And my mum bless her, she's always said she thinks it's a reason from God. She said that God has sort of kept me at this point and elevated me in the last couple of years, because if I had got big at 20 or 21, I'd probably be dead.
People really don't understand the work that you need to, you know, behind like being a musician. They think it's all like, oh, sex and drugs and rock and roll. They don't actually understand how hard it is. Like, you always need to live up to other people's expectations. You're touring, you're playing a show for 3 hours every single night.
One of the things that I've had to sort of like personally adjust to is come to the realization of like, the choices in which I was making in my lifestyle were hindering the very thing that I live for, which is like the live show and the music.
You know, as someone who was right there, like right from the start, like even when you played the small rooms, and I gotta tell you, like I feel like your live show was remarkable. You know, even back then, like your outfits were phenomenal, your moves were spot on. Like I really feel like you gave it your all even back then. Do you feel like that contributed to your success, like, or was it kind of like a fake it till you make it sort of situation?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. It's like, look, I'm not going to sit here and suck my own dick and say like I'm solely responsible. But I would definitely say leading up to the point where we came to America and released our first single like 5 years ago, you know, in a way, and I'm sure the other guys would agree, you know, it was the live performance and my complete relentless enthusiasm which really drove us through those years where we were not making any money.
Was it like a situation where the guys just wanted to give up and you were like, guys, keep going, like we got this, we can do this?
Like, no one was even willing to give up. I think it was actually opposite of that. It was, I think the other guys, you know, recognized, you know, very intelligently that, you know, on stage, like I'm an absolute like force of nature. And with that, as a group, when you've got something like that, it's just a case of having that one song, one or two songs that presents the band in a way to take it to the next level. So, you know, the sheer sort of like passion and relentless thing, it was an absolute drive. It was the thing that like got me up, and it was the thing that like made me want to push. And when I'm on stage, it's kind of like the only way I can describe it, it feels like a marathon where every time I feel like I'm slacking or I'm not at like 100%, I just keep pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing, because I know for a fact that the audience cannot help but feel that. And then when they feel that, they give it back to me, and it becomes this kind of thing of like give and take between myself and the audience, and of course the other guys in the band. But admittedly, you know, no one does quite as much like work on stage as I do. What separates us from everyone else is that I have a very clear defined idea of what it is to be a frontman and what it is to be a band when putting on a live show. And unfortunately, for a lot of other people because they're fucking missing out is that it's been forgotten. I wanna taste love and pain. Wanna feel pride and shame. I don't wanna take my time. Don't wanna waste one life. I wanna live better days. Never look back and say, could have been me. It could have been me. I learned so much from two things, two polar opposite things. Like, I learned sincerity from my father, watching him sing, and passion, singing about and to something he can't prove to anyone else, but he believes in, that is God, right? And the second thing was when I was doing pills and going to these raves, and I would look at the MC and I would look at the DJ and I would see that, like, people go to these events and these concerts to let themselves go.
Yeah, but you know, like, not everybody has a captivating personality on stage, I feel like. It doesn't mean that the audience is less involved. Like, let's say Radiohead, for example. You know, Tom York has a different energy and a different way of performing. Does it mean that he's not connecting or connecting less with his audience, with the fans? I mean, not everybody's music, not everybody's making music that makes the crowd active like yours does.
Well, in that case, I guess it's down to a personal preference. You know, my belief is, when I go to a festival, or when everyone goes to a festival, like, I would hope to think that people go there to have a good time, to dance and let themselves go. You know, it's like, it's nothing negative about Radiohead, but it's like their audience probably goes there expecting to sort of see the band plug in and, you know, Tom, like, giving it everything, and the guy's got a fucking great voice and whatnot. But in terms of myself and the Struts, especially now, we have, like, a reputation for bringing, like, the entertainment value. And I feel kind of, like, responsible, you know, every time we get up on stage or every time we jump into the lineup of a festival, it's kind of like, right, we're gonna, if this festival is designed to have variety, because look, we've done festivals with Radiohead where they've headlined. So I'm looking at the lineup and I'm like, well, you know what? You've got this band here, you've got this band here, you've got this band here. Like, Radiohead are gonna headline, they're gonna be fucking great, all their fans are gonna love it. But, you know, the Struts are going on like three bands before, right? Now, I wanna make sure that when people go to see us, that it's so much more than just a listening experience. I want people to be basically, like, attacked on all senses. I want them to sort of, like, be excited and get the blood moving and get the endorphins running in their heads and then looking around at each other and sort of seeing everyone else, like, letting themselves go. Like, it's like this, right? This always stuck with me. Like, when I was 8 years old, right? Mm-hmm. I went to a school disco, and all I wanted to fucking do the whole fucking night was dance, right? So I was hanging out, like, at the pick and mix shop, at the pick and mix store, like, at this school disco, and there was, like, probably about 30 kids, like, not really doing anything, and I was sipping on a Panda Pop, and, like, I remember thinking, like, fuck it, fuck this, I'm gonna do it. And I remember going to the dance floor, doing star jumps, and, like, proper getting into it, and they were playing, like, ooh, ee, ooh, ah, ah, ting, tang, walla, walla, bing, bang. And I was loving it. Then 10 minutes later, I see my dad in the corner of the school hall. And lo and behold, there was like 5 minutes left of the school disco. And it always stuck with me. I was like, fuck, why didn't I let myself go at the very beginning? And that's what I like to do with the Struts shows. I'm not a band who's going to wait 3/4 of the way through the set to get everyone to let themselves go. I want people to sort of like, as soon as I run out on stage, it's like, right, now's the time. Give me everything. I'm going to give you everything. Let's have a good time as long as we fucking possibly can.
You're definitely like, are not afraid to be yourself, which I think is admirable. But what kind of advice would you give fans that don't feel like they fit in?
I mean, stick by your guns and believe in what you're doing, because to an extent, I don't even feel like I fit in. Even now, like, I've had the privilege of opening up for some of the greatest bands in the world that the music industry has ever seen. And, you know, some people would think like, oh, that's like an acceptance. That's like that. Kudos for you. You know, it's like you've got Dave Grohl saying like, you're the best support band we've ever had. Or, you know, you've had conversations with Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. But to an extent, even now, I still feel like a complete outsider, because I think when you're doing something that you wholeheartedly believe in, it's not going to be easy. So I would say if a band feels like they're left out and they don't belong, then they're probably doing something right. It's like Oasis when they first came out. You know, no one would write anything about them, you know, and when they were rehearsing at the Boardwalk in Manchester, it was like the whole of the UK was taken over by this whole 90s like ecstasy scene where everyone was just hitting the clubs and stuff. And they were standing completely by themselves on their own. And it's the same with the Struts. When we broke out into London and we started playing Camden, and there was all of these fucking shoegazing bands like, you know, Catfish and the Bottlemen and Peace and fucking Temples. And like, they were getting all of the press. They were on the front cover of NME. They were the ones who were like getting played on Radio One. But, you know, we suddenly came along and the people of London hadn't seen a band like come in, you know, and fuck things up like a bull in a china shop and getting everyone to clap their hands, despite the popular belief that it's not cool to do that, or it wasn't at the time. So standing on your own and alone, I think, is the best thing you can do. And I tell you what, like, I've already seen in the last 5 years, there are bands coming out now, like in LA, in London, in Paris, that have like seen what we're doing. And it's so fucking cool that they're becoming inspired by that.
A question we really love asking on the show is, when should somebody say, you know what, I'm not making it, maybe it's time to give up?
When you say them words, you know, like... I mean, look, here's the truth. I never once ever thought that it wasn't going to happen. I didn't know what level. And in all honesty, I could be hit by a fucking bus tomorrow and I'd probably float up to wherever I'm going pretty fucking content. you know, self-belief is like everything. And I guess if you really believe that you want to do this and you're going to bring something special, then you have to have like an unshakable plan in your head. Because I do believe it's all about projection. I think there have been times where me and the band have joked about saying, oh, this is it, you know, like, this is never going to happen again. And, you know, or so-and-so is going to completely, like, take over and what we basically started and, you know, shit that bands talk about. You know, and I say to them, like, look, shut the fuck up. Like, and me included, like, you can't say that shit. You know, it's like every time, you know, the Beatles would feel down, like, John would literally say, like, where the fuck are we going? And they would say, to the top, John. And like, it's like, I do believe in mantras. I believe in projection so much.
But also I think that you have to want something like so much, you know, it has to be like a do or die sort of situation. Like, I feel like a lot of musicians, you know, they don't push themselves hard enough or as much as they should, you know. Maybe it's their egos, maybe it's their insecurities, maybe they're so afraid of failure and it's holding them back. I don't know, but if you're not gonna go all the way, you're probably just, you know, you're not gonna make it.
It's two things. All the matter, like, a great song, one fucking song can change your life forever. So first and foremost, it's fucking music. Like, you can look as good as you desire, you can come across as intelligent as you may or may not be, but if you ain't got fucking great songs, then you haven't got anything. Because anyone in this game, you know, if they've got half a brain cell, they'll realize that the songs will outlive their interviews, their name, everything. And secondly as well, it's fucking hard work. Because with every year that goes by, there's some other cunt on the other side of the world with the same ambition as you, probably better looking than you, skinnier than you, better with women than you, and probably smarter than you. And you have to have a competitive streak as well as being like motivated and creative at the same time.
What about criticism? How do you deal with criticism?
I think it's common sense. It's like, God, I think a reaction is better than no reaction. It's quite funny. Like, I've heard some people talk about my music and the way I sing with such a passion of, like, so, like, fueled with a genuine hateful passion that it almost like makes their blood fucking boil that I could be doing what I'm doing, and it makes them angry. And that's fucking great, you know, and it's actually quite refreshing, because with social media and everything these days and being on tour all the time, I'm surrounded by people that I do love and trust. But, you know, unless I was to really put someone in a corner and say, look, is this shit, you know, am I doing the right thing? Which, to be honest, I haven't really ever got to that place of being so insecure what I'm doing. But to hear the flip side of the coin is also really good. I'd rather someone fucking idolize me or want to crucify me. Like, I don't want anything in between.
Let's talk about the band. You know, what's your dynamic? Who's in charge of what? Like, give me a little bit of insight on your mates.
My mates? Well, every band kind of, like, has its own dynamic. I would say, for the most part, It's just one of those natural things where not only do I write music, but I'm also the singer, and I would consider my greatest thing that I can bring to songs are lyrics and titles. So with that being said, like, I'm at the forefront of everything that we're doing, for the most part, creatively, right? I think with the Struts, because it's... And don't get me wrong, I'm not some control freak. I just know what I like. I know what I like, and the fact is I'm not gonna sit out there. I'm not gonna get out there and convince myself that I'm loving something that I'm not feeling. And it's taken a long time, but I've kind of adopted more of a leadership role when it comes to the creative. Now, there's other things, like every band member has their strength, you know, like for instance, Adam, like, you know, not only being a great songwriter himself, me and him have been working with each other for years, but, you know, he's really sort of coming into his own with like the business and the financial side, you know, so... For instance, me and I can talk to Adam and say like, hey, you know, so this show that we've got going, like how much are we looking at, da 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 da, what can we take in terms of production? And he normally has like a very good idea on that, you know. And then there's Jed, who is a very sociable guy who is very charming and is good with people. And I'm not good with people. Like, for instance, when we're doing shows and we're on tour, our backstage is just like full of people, especially if we're doing a market like New York or LA. It will be filled to the brim with like from people from my agencies, people from friends of friends, and da 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 da. And the band have kind of come to realize, and everyone else around me as well, is that I don't like to get involved in that. It's like, I know that might sound pedantic. It's just like one of those things where I want to prepare for the show.
Is it expected of you to be social like all the time?
Yeah, it can be. It can be. And the band know that I'm not good at hiding my emotions. Like, and admittedly, I've made a lot of mistakes, and I may have even damaged some relationships because I have trouble controlling my moods and my emotions. Like, for instance, when I get off stage, I don't care who the fuck you are. I'm not talking to you. Like, I've done my fucking job. I'm out, mate, right? I've clocked off. Like, I'm going to go have a shower, have a cigarette, get dressed. I might talk to you in an hour or so.
Can't
tell
right now.
Okay. All right.
The band isn't organized like a dictatorship. You know, it's like it's about sharing each other's responsibility. But obviously, as the frontman, the singer, and one of the main songwriters, it's just one of those things. A lot of the responsibility does fall on me. But even how I treat myself now on the road, it's like, you know, I started doing tours where I was basically like completely sober, and I'd probably smoke a bit of weed every now and then. But, you know, the drinking and everything just had to stop because we were doing so many shows in a row. You know, we did 62 shows in one tour,
wow,
with basically like not more than one day off. Like, we never had a day off
yeah,
show.
Yeah, how do you stay safe?
You know, I had to do that. And the band, where credit's due, knew how much it was like taking out of all of us, but especially me. And, you know, it was great because we started getting to a place where they started to take more of the interviews, and, you know, they would sometimes go and visit people who wanted to meet the band and start some sort of like relationship in terms of like an opportunity or whatnot, you know, because you've got to spread the weight out.
Well, why can't you take a break? Do you have to play a show like every single night? Why just not taking a couple of days off or something?
Because, okay, it's kind of our own fault, right? So, let me just break it down for you. I want the best possible production that we can afford at our level. And I don't want to be in a van. I want to be in a bus. And, you know, I want crew members, which admittedly, some people would argue that I don't need them there, but they make me happy. So all of these things cost money. And mm-hmm. it just becomes a simple fact of, like, for instance, if you're to do a show, and then sit in a car park with a bus and a driver and crew members and everyone and a truck that we have a semi now with a separate driver, you know, when you're having more than one day off, you're literally just burning money. So
yeah,
we're at a fucking great point where we are doing minimum like 1500 people a night, like minimum, and killing it when it comes to like people wanting to buy t-shirts and stuff. But we're also at the point where we're like, you know what? Like we know we can do this. We know that we can play a huge amount of shows and get through it as long as I take care of myself, and then finish a tour and be able to actually like make some great cash and sort of go home and spend it on our family and big rings for girlfriends.
All right, Log, I think it's time to bring some of your fans to ask you some questions.
Hi, I'm Leah.
Hi, Leah.
So my question is, you have a lot of outfit changes during your live show and a lot of versions of your 21st century dandy outfit. Which one's your favorite to wear and why?
Great question. I actually really love the blue 21st century dandy outfit, which was the last of kind of like that series of the color split down the middle. It's blue and silver. And I remember after the first three were made, I spoke to Ray, who makes all my outfits. And I said, you know what? Like, I had another outfit done, which was orange, but I had to stop wearing it because it was fabric. And after 45 minutes on stage, I'd have this giant sweat patch in my crotch area, which looked like basically I'd piss myself every night. So I was like, right, we've got to go back to leather. But I loved the tassels. They were great. And so it's kind of like the best of both worlds. I love that outfit. I think it's my favorite. And the first time I wore it was, I'd never tried it on before, until 5 a.m. in New York City, like 2 hours before we went live for Good Morning America. So it holds a lot of good memories.
Awesome. I like that one too. But I like the black and white one as well.
Yeah, a lot of people like the black and white one. Like the I've got the Funko Pop.
Ooh, by the way, we're going to give one of Luke's Funko Pop this week on our Instagram page. So make sure to head there to our page for more details. Thanks so much for calling and thanks for coming on our show.
Thank you.
All right, let's welcome our next guest. Hello. Hey.
Hi.
Can you please introduce yourself and tell us where you're from?
My name is Zia, and I'm from Kansas.
Kansas?
Yes, sir.
I can see all of your Struts memorabilia. You got a signed drumhead.
Oh, yeah. Can you show us what you have over there?
I can try, yes. I don't know if you can see it very well.
Wow.
All right. She's a fan, all right.
And you've got the WAPS picture right there, our biggest fan.
Yes, sir.
All right. So what's your question to Luke today?
My question to Luke is, what is your favorite part of performing live? Not necessarily a song, but like a moment when you're on stage.
Well, I really love, I mean, it's, I don't want to answer with the song, but it kind of, I have to, but when we do Somebody New and it's just me and the piano, it's kind of really cool. It's like, by that time, the audience are kind of so worn out. And everyone's just kind of like waiting for something a little bit more quiet and intimate. And it's the only real time in the show where I can really literally sit down and take my time and be on an instrument that I love playing. There's something about being on a piano which is kind of like just it brings like a really nice zen quality to everything, and I just love playing that track and really having fun with it and taking my time, and hearing everyone sing it is great. So that's definitely my favorite part of the show for sure.
It's a beautiful song.
You made her cry, so there you go.
I cried a lot last night too. I'm sorry, Luke. Such a mess.
That's all right, love. Should we cry together?
Crying is healthy.
It's good.
Do you know,
this is actual fact, like, but when you cry, there's a chemical in the teardrops that contain like the active chemical for stress, which is why like sometimes when you cry a lot, you get really tired afterwards because you become super relaxed. So
I should cry more often. Maybe I'll sleep better.
Don't hold back the tears, you know, it's easier.
Thanks so much for your great question. And thanks so much for coming on our show. Hopefully we'll see you soon at a Struts show.
Bye.
All right. Bye bye. Ooh, I see our next fan here. Hey,
hi.
Hey there. Please introduce yourself, your name, where you're from.
I'm Madison Cole. I'm from Michigan.
Hello, Madison. I love Michigan.
Hi, Luke.
I love Michigan. Detroit. Well, are you close to Detroit?
No. You actually asked that the last time I met you. We spoke on the New Year's Day. I said I was from Michigan, and that's exactly what you asked.
Did I?
At least you're consistent.
You know why? Because I fucking love Murder City. Like, it's it's created some of my favorite bands of all time. So I'm just going to pretend you're from Detroit. It's cool.
Okay. My question was, has there been any time where anything has gone wrong or any embarrassing moments on stage?
Yes. Yes. Where do I begin?
Yeah.
So I've had a wardrobe malfunction, which was really fun. So I think this was when we first started playing in the States, and I hadn't had any sort of like custom outfits made. I only had like two things made by Xander Rhodes, and other than that I would go into sort of like, you know, what you guys called thrift shops and look for sort of like one-off things which I thought were cool. Anyway, I bought these leather trousers and I was like, yeah man, these are sick, and I was wearing them for quite a few shows. And anyway, we get up to do this show and this festival, and the crowd is like huge, which we were very surprised at because it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So but beaming sunlight anyway. So anyway, I'm singing and I'm like, you know, I'm shaking my ass, doing all my moves, you know, that I'm worldly famous for. And all of a sudden, I'm like, I literally feel a draft. And I'm like, what the fuck? Like,
oh no.
I'm like, what's going on? What's going on? Anyway, so I put my hand like to my back and my trousers have split all the way down. And like my ass is like hanging out. And the funny thing is like I didn't have like what you call boxer shorts on. I had these white briefs. So these trousers were like black, and I was like, fuck. I was like literally two songs in and we were meant to be doing like a 50-minute set. So basically what I did was everyone behind me is laughing, like Geffen's on the drum kit, like pissing himself because the rip's getting bigger and bigger. It started off like that. Then it got to like here till it literally became like a onesie, you know, with like the buttons that you used to sort of like, you could have your bum sort of hanging out of. And I managed to do the whole entire show without turning around once to the audience. But everyone behind me, including the crew, could just see me dancing around and pretending to be like, you know, this, that, and the other. And my white bum was sort of like hanging out.
I bet you the girls would prefer you doing it the other way around, like with your ass towards them.
You know, who knows?
Well, speaking of Luke's bum, we got to see it earlier here today. So maybe you'll get to see it later. We'll see. We'll see if we'll edit this out or not.
And thanks for coming out on our show today.
Thank you so much.
That's all right, love. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Okay, see ya. Bye. Bye, Luke.
Bye-bye.
All right, let's bring the next one in.
Hello, how are you doing?
I'm doing good. How about you guys? Oh my gosh.
Ooh, nice shirt you got there.
Yeah, look at this Strut shirt. It's great.
Can you please introduce yourself, like where you're from?
I'm Campbell King, and I'm from Missouri in the United States.
I love your hair. Is it naturally this curly?
Yes, it is. I did it just for this, actually.
So I'm thinking about maybe getting like a loose perm slash like mullet cut. Like, what do you think?
I think you could pull it off really well, especially with your natural hair, because I love it. Like, just everything about it is beautiful.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm trying not to blush.
My question is, if you had 24 hours to have a day with any artist, like music artist, dead or alive, who would it be and what would you do?
God, you know what? Like, there's a lot of obvious ones, you know, like, obviously Freddie Mercury and Steven Tyler and all these other kind of rock and rollers. But the truth be told, I would love to sit. It's on a summer's evening, about 5 p.m. on the streets of Paris in one of those Parisian sort of coffee shops, which they serve alcohol, because all of them fucking do. And I would love to sip champagne with Edith Piaf and get really drunk with her. And then we could put our hats down in the middle of the street and start busking.
Whoa, what an unexpected answer.
But it's true.
It's great.
That's probably not right, but yeah. I could teach her some English folk songs. She could teach me how to sing in French. You know, mon français est très bien.
I know a little bit of French. I only took about a year of it, but it's a little bit in my head.
Good. All you need to know is how to swear. That's it. Like in any language.
Thanks so much for coming on our show. Seriously, stay safe, stay sane.
Thank you so much.
Look, I love this cat you brought on out of nowhere. I think my cat and him can be really good friends. Should I bring my cat in?
This cat is a real mischievous boy.
I gotta bring him to every episode, because look how cute he is.
Oh my god.
Charlie, say hi to Luke.
Look at him. Is he a Maine Coon?
That's a Charlie Chainsaw.
A Charlie fucking chainsaw. What kind of a name of it?
It's because when I got him, he was like so tiny, but he was purring like so loud, like a chainsaw. Like,
I thought you meant Charlie Chainsaw was a breed of cat. I was like, what is that?
What's your cat's name?
This is my significant other's. He's called Ziggy.
Hi, Ziggy. Ziggy and Charlie, I see a friendship forming here. Look, they like each other.
Here, can you hear him purring?
Oh, wow. Yeah, it is loud.
Is that a chainsaw or what?
Sounds like a nice Jaguar purring, like the car. Ow.
All right. Thanks so much for being on my show, Luke. Thanks for coming. Thanks for giving me your time. I love you. I love the Struts. Can't wait to see you on stage again, hopefully soon.
Thank you. Thank you very much, love.
Thanks for spending your quarantine with us, everybody. I want to thank my sound engineer, Seth Spector, my lovely co-producer, Audrey Lacey, all the fans that came on the show, all the fans at home. Please like, subscribe to our channel. Leave me a comment. Who do you want to see on the next episode of Super Unknown? Until the next time, stay safe, stay sane. Thanks for coming, everybody. I'll see you soon. Bye.
All right, keep on dancing.
All right, love. Speak to you in a bit. Bye.
I'll give you one night.